knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
Okay, let's practice calculating free energy change. Consider the following enthalpy and entropy data for water in both the liquid and gaseous state. So here is that data. We have delta H values for the liquid and gas form of water, and we have delta S values for the liquid and gas form of water. So the question is, what is the free energy change for the vaporization of water at room temperature? So we're looking at the process of liquid water going to water vapor or water in the gas phase, and we want to know the free energy change associated with that process. So if this is confusing, go ahead and check out my tutorial on thermodynamics, and when you're ready, give this a try. So let's put our data up top, and then just to remind ourselves, we are looking at this process. We are looking at water in the liquid phase going to water in the gas phase. That is a vaporization. Now we want to calculate the delta H and the delta S associated with this process. So for delta H, since we have this enthalpy of formation data, we know that we can take the enthalpy of formation of products and subtract from that the enthalpy of formation of reactants, and that will give us the delta H for that process. So we can say that the standard enthalpy is equal to negative 241.82, that's the enthalpy of formation for water vapor, minus negative 286.83, that's the enthalpy of formation of liquid water. And that will be equal to 45.01 kilojoules per mole. So that is the standard enthalpy change for this vaporization. Now, we can do the same thing for entropy because we have this entropy data. So, standard entropy change will be 188.8, that is the data given for water vapor, minus 70.0, that is the data given for liquid water. And that will be equal to 118.8 joules per mole Kelvin. So, now that we have enthalpy and entropy data, what are we going to do with that? Well, we know that the standard free energy change is going to be given by this expression. So we have delta G equals delta H minus T delta S. And so we now have all of this information. So let's plug some things in. Delta G is going to be equal to delta H, which is 45.01 kilojoules per mole, minus T, which is going to be 298 Kelvin. Remember, we said this is done at room temperature. That's 298 Kelvin. And then for delta S, we're going to take the delta S value that we had, but this is very important. We need to make sure that the units on delta H and delta S agree. Delta H had kilojoules, so the easiest thing to do here is to convert our delta S from joules per mole K to kilojoules per mole K, which means we have to divide by 1,000. So that is going to be 0.1188 kilojoules per mole Kelvin. A lot of students forget to do that, and that will give you an incorrect answer. So make sure that your units agree. And if we do the arithmetic, that gives us 9.6 kilojoules per mole. So that is our delta G value. We want to understand that that is positive, and so that corresponds to a non-spontaneous process. So we have an endothermic process, meaning it is enthalpically unfavorable, right? From the standpoint of enthalpy, this is an unfavorable process. And so even though the entropy change is positive, meaning it is entropically favorable because the water molecules are going from the liquid phase to the gas phase, there is a greater dispersal of matter, so it is entropically favorable. The enthalpic unfavorability outweighs the entropic favorability to give us a positive delta G value, making this a non-spontaneous process. And that makes sense because if you have a glass of water sitting on the table in room temperature, it does not spontaneously go all into the gas phase. It is going to pretty much stay just as liquid water. So that makes sense with our intuition, and that is the answer for this problem.
Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.